everybody. I have a pleasure to introduce John Barrow, but I think I have no, there is no necessity to introduce him because he is very well known in Poland because of his many books translated into our language. But perhaps it would be useful if I say a few less known details concerning John Barrow. John Barrow made his doctorate at the Magdalen College in Oxford under Denis Sciama. Denis Sciama is a chapter in the history of cosmology himself. In 1999, John was appointed professor of the Department of Applied Science in Cambridge, a very noble institution, also very merited for the history of cosmology. It's pity that this institute, this department, no, as far as building itself is concerned, does not exist anymore, because a new one, a new institute was constructed, very modern one. The old one was not very beautiful, very, well, rather strange building with many rooms, many corridors, but with a very typical character. I remember my first, more personal, so to speak, encounter with John was also by reading one of his books. And the book was entitled Left Hand of Creation. It was the first ever popular book written by John. It was 1983. I liked that book very, very much. It's pity that, as far as I know, it's not republished later. Perhaps because cosmology is evolving very quickly, it is much easier to write a new one than to update the old one. Why I like this book very much? Because it presents not only beautiful images of the universe, galaxies, clusters, and explosions of stars, and so forth, but it also shows, and it was rather exceptional at that time, some theoretical structures without which understanding of the universe is impossible. And it was done in this little book in a very, very precise and very popular, accessible way. Tonight, John will be speaking about the origin and evolution of the universe. I think that the most symmetrical thing is absolute nothingness. It's absolutely symmetrical. And coming of the universe into being was a breaking of, violation of that symmetry. And by doing that, the universe had two options. Either became left-handed or right-handed. And there are many reasons to believe that the universe is in fact left-handed. And if we take into account the structure of DNA, then the universe, and this is a very important structure in the universe, and then the world is, very strictly speaking, left-handed. And I think it is a very good, good place to ask John, with my left hand, to take the floor and to say us something about the origin and evolution of the universe.
Thank you very much for your introduction. I've known Michael Heller for a very long time. I won't say how long, but as he indicates, right back to 1983 and before, we have been interested in many of the same questions and perhaps many of the same answers regarding cosmology and the structure of the universe. Now, in the first quarter of the 20th century, what I believe to be the greatest scientific discovery ever made was achieved. It was made possible and made intelligible by Einstein's development of a new theory of gravitation, one that superseded the theory of Newton's developed 300 years earlier. And that theory gave rise to a prediction that the entire universe, everything there is in a state of dynamic change, a state of expansion. This is rather revolutionary because for thousands of years, philosophers and scientists had believed that the space around us was ultimately static and fixed like a theatrical stage, and on it were played out the motions of the stars and the planets and the other heavenly bodies. But there was nonetheless a fixed stage to which everything could be referred. Einstein predicted that there was no such fixed stage, that the whole universe ought to be in a state of change. Well, that theoretical possibility was unraveled and made clear by Alexander Friedmann and by Georges Lemaître, who both made clear that there could be pictures of the universe which were in a state of overall expansion. And towards the end of the 1920s, Edwin Hubble and Milton Humason were able to discover such a state to be observationally verified. What they did was to measure the systematic shift in the colors of light from stars in distant galaxies, and to show that that light was being stretched to longer wavelengths by the expansion of the universe. So it appeared redder in the optical part of the spectrum. And here is the famous picture that became known as Hubble's Law. This is a version from long ago in the 1970s. And it plots the speed with which distant sources of light are moving away from us against their distance in millions of parsecs. A parsec is about 3 1/3 light years, about 31 trillion kilometers, 31 million million. And you can see that even by astronomers' standards, there's a pretty good straight line showing that the speed grows in proportion to the distance away of the light source. Today, if we were to draw the same picture, we would have the same type of graph. Here are the speeds, but look at the distances. Here we were to 50 million parsecs. Now we're 8 times further, 400 million parsecs. And we see the same systematic trend, and something we'll return to at the end, an interesting upward curvature of that straight line when we go to the very greatest distances. So what you're seeing there is a witness to how hard people work, both in the subject of quantum electronics and also in astronomy, so that you can make detectors that can see things that are fainter and further away to stretch this axis that great distance. It's very easy to say that the universe is expanding, but what does that mean? Are we expanding? Hopefully not. The Earth, is that expanding? No. Is the solar system expanding? No. Is our galaxy expanding? Are the local group of our galaxies expanding? No. None of these structures is taking part in the expansion of the universe because they're held together by other forces that are stronger over the scale of their dimension than the effect of the universal expansion. To find the markers that trace out the expansion of the universe, you have to go out to the scale of great clusters of galaxies containing hundreds and maybe thousands of galaxies. These are the markers that take part in the expansion. Everything that's smaller is just dragged along for the ride. The next interesting point to make about the expansion is that it's not an explosion. The universe is not expanding into anything. There is no outside, there is no edge to the expansion, and there is no center. So the fact that everything is expanding away from us does not mean that we are at the center of the universe. Well, it's easy to say that, simple to understand it first for the case if the universe is infinite. If the universe is infinite, then there is clearly no edge. But there is also no center. You can see this fairly clearly from Escher's famous engraving of this network of never-ending crisscrossing girders. Whichever intersection you stand on and look around you, it appears as though you are at the center of the network. If we heated up the girders, all these distances would expand, and the network would appear to expand away from you as though you were at the center of the network, the same in every direction. So every point acts as though it was a center in this rather non-Aristotelian universe. But what about the finite universe? This seems to be much more problematic. If you have a finite piece of flat paper like this, how could it not have a center and not have an edge? Well, Einstein's theory of gravitation also introduced the concept that space is not fixed and flat, but it can be curved and dynamical and changeable. And if we have a surface which is two-dimensional, but not like this piece of flat paper, but curved like the surface of a ball, then you can see that if you are in this two-dimensional universe, whose space is this curved surface, you could walk around on the surface and you would never run into an edge. If you inflate the balloon, then if you mark these galaxies out on it, as Eddington first suggested, then these points move away from one another, and whichever point you sit on, you will see the others moving away from you as though you're at the center. So the curvature of this space allows it to have no boundary, no edge, to expand, but yet have no center of expansion on its surface of space. A picture we'll see several times in this talk is this one. It's a map, a tracing of the expansion size of the universe, the separation, say, between two of those distant clusters marking the expansion, and time in billions of years. And here's the expanding trajectory of the universe. And we are about here, close to about 13.7 billion years after the apparent beginning to the expansion, back here at a time we'll call zero. One of the things that the expanding universe picture creates for us is a sense of cosmic history. The universe changes as time passes. The conditions within it change. The temperature, the density of material, and the brightness of light. Today, the temperature is very low, of radiation only about 3 degrees above absolute zero. If we run the clock backwards to when the universe is about 250,000 years old, then the temperature will be 1,000 times greater because the size will be 1,000 times more contracted. At this time, the temperature will be about 3,000 degrees, and it will be too hot for there to be any atoms or any molecules, any planets or stars. The universe is a rather uninteresting place, lots of radiation, lots of elementary particles. But as time moves forward from 250,000 years, the universe cools enough for simple atoms to form, then molecules, then some parts of the expansion expanding a little slower than the average because they're a bit denser, will start to separate from the expansion. and they will eventually collapse under their own gravity, and stars will form, and planets will form, and complicated biochemical processes become possible, as they have on the surface of the Earth. So we see that time really plays an important role in this unfolding history of conditions in the universe. The long-range forecast is really rather bleak in many ways. Eventually, as we'll see later, the Sun will exhaust its energy and implode to a size similar to that of the Earth, yet being a million times more massive. More massive stars will have more complicated fates, forming perhaps neutron stars or black holes. But eventually, all structures in the universe will fade away and evaporate, and the universe will become rather lifeless, filled with radiation and stable elementary particles, a less interesting place than it is today. We'll now ask a few questions about this state of the universe that we find today. Why do we find the universe to be so old, about 14 billion years old? And the answer is rather interesting. We shouldn't be surprised to find the universe is that old, because the type of building blocks of biochemical complexity of which we are made do not come ready-made in the universe. They're produced in the stars by a long sequence of nuclear reactions and supernova explosions. They may even go through stars more than once. So all the atoms of carbon within us have been made by these simple nuclear reactions that combine to make beryllium, and then beryllium plus helium to make carbon. And if you go further, carbon plus another helium will make oxygen, and everything heavier than oxygen. So all the carbon nuclei in the DNA molecules in your bodies have been through a star. But these processes take lots of time, many billions of years to go to completion and distribution around the universe. So we shouldn't be surprised to find that the universe is many billions of years old. If the universe was significantly younger, there wouldn't be time to make the ingredients that are required for biochemical complexity and life as we know it. You might have thought that a universe that was just millions of years old would be quite old enough for complicated things to happen. But there simply wouldn't have been time to make the building blocks of interesting complexity. The second question we can ask is, why is the universe so big? Why are we talking about tens of billions of light years? Why are other stars and galaxies so distant? The answer to this question is bound up with the answer to the previous one. Because the universe is going to need to exhibit billions of years of time to make the building blocks of life, if it's also expanding, in the same period of time, it's going to become billions of light years in extent. A universe that was just the size of the Milky Way galaxy would contain 100 billion potential sites for life, but it would be little more than a month old. So it's hardly enough time to pay off your credit card bill, let alone evolve complexity and life. The third peculiar fact about the universe is, to a first approximation, there's nothing in it. It's empty. The amount of matter in the universe is really tiny. If we were to take all the matter in the universe and divide it into equally spaced atoms, then there would be one atom on the average in every cubic meter of space. You can't make a vacuum that's as empty as that in any laboratory on Earth. This density, if we express it differently, having one atom in every cubic meter, if we were to draw those atoms together into planets, it corresponds to running into one planet like the Earth every 10 light years of the universe, and one star like the Sun every 1,000 light years, and one galaxy like the Milky Way every 10 million light years. So this tiny amount of matter in the universe is why the distances to other planets, to other stars and other galaxies are so enormous. It's a reflection of the very low density of the universe today. And that's a reflection of its great age and the very large amount of expansion that's taken place. It's diminished the density dramatically over billions of years. Another consequence of this that I always used to try to impress upon our children, that the universe is cool, very cool. So today the temperature is just about 2.7 degrees above absolute zero. And again, this is a reflection of its enormous age and the enormous amount of expansion that's taken place to give it that age. Every time it increases in size, it doubles in size, the radiation temperature halves. And this leads to a dramatic and simple feature of our universe that you wouldn't perhaps suspect has anything to do with cosmology. And it's the fact that the sky is dark at night. This was first recognized as a profound problem by Edmund Halley, after whom Halley's comet is named, a little over 300 years ago. He was interested in this question as to whether the universe is infinite or not. And he realized that if you contemplated a universe that contained an infinite number of stars, there seemed to be an awkward problem. Because if you just went to the forest and looked out towards the trees, in every direction, your line of sight soon ends on the trunk of a tree. And all you see in front of you is a phalanx, a line of tree trunks. So Halley asked, why don't you see the same thing when you look out into the universe? Why doesn't your line of sight everywhere end on the surface of a star? And so the whole sky should look like the surface of the sun all the time, and there would never be any night. This rather profound observation was not answered until the 20th century, quite late in the 20th century, and the discovery of the expansion of the universe. Because there is so little matter in the universe, as we've just seen, if we were to turn it all into radiation, just like that, using Einstein's E equals mc squared, it would hardly have any effect on the brightness of the sky. The temperature would increase from 3 degrees above absolute zero to about 15 degrees above absolute zero. There's too little matter in the universe to illuminate the sky. And that's a consequence of the expansion. If we go back in time to when the universe was 1,000 times smaller, then the temperature of the radiation would be 3,000 degrees, and the sky is bright all the time. So there was a bright sky, but it's in the past, when the universe was hotter and denser, and life and stars and planets were impossible. So what we've seen as a result of asking these questions are some observations about the universe which are rather peculiar, that turn upside down many centuries, even millennia, of philosophical speculation and deduction about the universe. So someone like Bertrand Russell thought that the darkness and inhospitable nature of the universe indicated that really life was but an accident, there couldn't be any meaning to the universe in terms of life. But what we see is that these peculiar properties of the universe, the fact that it's almost empty, that it's big, that it's old, that it's dark, that it's cold, are actually necessary conditions if a universe is going to contain complexity and life of any sort. So this is a rather unexpected contribution to the debate between philosophy and cosmology and science, that aspects of the universe that you might have thought were antithetical to life turn out to be rather important ingredients in creating a hospitable environment. Well, universes are rather like your stocks and shares. they don't necessarily only go up, they can also go down. In fact, they can plummet, just like your shares. And here's our picture again of size against time. There are universes of the sort we have just seen that just keep on expanding forever. But there are also universes which contain a higher density of material that decelerates the expansion so significantly that eventually the expansion will reverse into contraction and an apparent big crunch in the far future. In between, there is a type of universe that astronomers call a critical universe. I call it the British compromise universe, that just expands rapidly enough to keep going forever. And if you added one more atom to it, it would collapse to a crunch. Our universe is really quite close to that critical divide, within about 2% of it. And this is rather peculiar, because it needs a very special starting speed in order to stay close to that critical divide for a long, long time, and not peel off and collapse prematurely, or run away in super rapid expansion. If you do run away here, or you collapse too soon, you will not have time to make the galaxies and the stars that you need to seed complexity and interesting biochemistry. So it's a big mystery for cosmologists. First, why is the expansion going so close to that divide? And secondly, why is the expansion going at the same rate in every direction to very, very high precision of one part in 100,000? Most of what we know in detail about the very early stages of the universe is bound up with the fact that when the universe is young and dense, it's rather like an explosion having gone off. And whenever there's an explosion, there is fallout, there is radiation left over. And in 1948, two American radio astronomers predicted that there should be heat radiation left over from the hot early beginning of the universe. And its temperature should today be quite close to about 5 degrees above absolute zero. So that prediction came 50 years ago this year, discovery. And the radiation was discovered by Penzias and by Wilson. And since then, it's been studied in ever-increasing detail from experiments from the ground, in balloons, and most recently in three big satellite projects. Here is the spectrum of the radiation. Its temperature turned out to be about 2.73 degrees above absolute zero, so quite close to the prediction by Penzias and Wilson. This is a plot of its intensity against its frequency. The solid curve is the pattern you would expect for pure heat radiation, a so-called black body curve. And these points are indicative of where the data points from the observations are, merely indicative because the precision of the observations is so great that the uncertainty would be thinner than the thinnest line that you could draw on this picture by a very large factor. So this is the most perfect example of heat radiation ever discovered in nature. Having made that discovery long ago, this picture of the hot early beginning to the universe, the so-called Big Bang, although we don't know if there was a beginning or not, has become really the standard picture of what we think the universe's early history was like. The great puzzles that existed to this picture, the questions that were unanswered back in 1980, were the first two we just mentioned. Why are we close to this critical expansion when it seems that you always want to peel away from it? Why is the expansion the same in every direction? And lastly, why is the expansion not perfectly smooth? Why are there things like galaxies and stars in the universe? The fact that we observe them tells us that there's a sort of graininess in the universe. It's perfectly smooth, but plus another one part in 100,000 non-uniformity level out of which all the stars and galaxies form. Why is it this number? If the uniformity was 10 times better, there wouldn't be any stars and galaxies. If it was 10 times more non-uniform, everything would quickly evolve to black holes, and there would be no galaxies and stars. So this number is an important one to try and understand, to see where it comes from. Well, cosmologists began to make some important progress in answering all those questions at one go, back in 1980 and 1981, when a new idea was introduced into the subject by the American particle physicist Alan Guth. And his idea is really a simple modification of the picture that we saw just now of size against time. If you were looking closely, you would have noticed that that trajectory of the expanding universe, whether it was going to expand forever or collapse, always curved over in that direction. And this was a sign that it was decelerating. Once the expansion began, gravity comes into play and acts to decelerate the expansion by attracting all the constituents towards one another. Guth proposed that at early times there was just a short interlude, a brief interlude where the expansion accelerated and this curve curved upwards rather than downwards. This idea has all sorts of remarkable consequences. While it takes place, it drives the expansion closer and closer to that critical divide. You can see that by looking at this picture. If this hadn't happened, then the expansion would have carried on and reached this size by this time. But the acceleration makes expansion much more enlarged by this time here than it otherwise would have been, and pushes the expansion towards the critical divide for huge expanses of time. Also, while this is going on, the expansion in every direction is accelerated to the same rate, to very high precision. So you end up with expansion which is the same in every direction. This idea was not completely unmotivated and ad hoc. In 1980, particle physicists had developed new theories of what should happen at very, very high energies. And these theories like to predict the existence of new types of particle that were usually called scalar fields. A year or two ago, we discovered the first example with the Higgs boson. And these particles had the property that they anti-gravitated, that they exerted a negative pressure or a tension upon one another. And if they came into existence, were produced by the heat radiation at this time, they would indeed produce this accelerating effect in the expansion by their gravitational repulsion for each other. The process was envisaged to come to an end because these particles were likely to be unstable, and they would decay away into ordinary radiation and other particles after a short period of time, and that's why the expansion resumes its normal course. So that is the standard picture, really, of inflation. There are huge amounts of detail about the identity of those particles, how they interact, what happens, how long this lasts, and how they decay. But this simple picture should give you the idea of how the universe's dynamics would dramatically change as a result of that process. Here is the same process pictured in a different way. If we sit here today and we had a perfect telescope, we might expect to see about 14 billion light years. That's the greatest distance from which light would have had time to travel since the expansion began. That's not the edge of the universe, but it's our horizon. We haven't had time to collect light from anywhere further away. And cosmologists call that the visible universe. Suppose we run its expansion backwards to earlier and earlier times. it will become smaller and smaller and smaller. If we had this accelerated burst of inflation, then it's possible at very early times for that whole visible universe to be the expanded image of a region that is small enough for light signals to travel all the way across it at that early time and make sure that it's smooth and its properties are similar from one place to another, from one side to another at that early time. If the inflation hadn't happened, then we would be expanding the universe from a region that's 10 to the 25 times too big for that coordination to have been possible. So this picture allows us to understand why we would expect, on the average, the temperature and density of the universe to be almost exactly the same everywhere we look on the largest scales, because it inherits the smoothness of that little initial patch which has expanded to become our whole visible universe. But soon people realized that you could say rather more. That little patch cannot be perfectly smooth. There must always be quantum fluctuations and statistical fluctuations of thermodynamics within it. And they would be inflated and stretched and expanded as well. And we would end up seeing them manifested as little variations in the temperature and the density of the universe at later times, all the way up to the present. So people set about trying to predict in detail what those patterns should look like when you saw them in the radiation of the universe. The exciting prospect was that these little quantum statistical fluctuations would turn into variations in density that would be the seeds of the galaxies and stars and planets that we see today. Well, this is what spawned three spectacular satellite missions to map that radiation in detail. So the first one measured that spectrum to great precision to predict that the radiation was indeed radiation from a heat source. It also detected for the first time the fluctuations in the temperature from one direction to another. The most recent sky map from 2013 to 2014, and it will be updated, I think, one more time, observations ceased last October, is the European Space Agency project known as the Planck mission. And this is a particular map in appropriate celestial coordinates in which the little variations in colour from the purple to the red end of the spectrum are showing you variations slightly below and slightly above the average temperature, which changes of color between 10 microkelvin, so 10 millionths of a degree and smaller. And if you're a statistician, you would probably believe that this is an example of what would be called a Gaussian process. There are not enough extremes of deep red or deep purple for it to be significantly non-random in that sense. But astronomers expect there to be some non-randomness in this distribution and work very hard to find statistical measures to try to extract it. If you analyze this map, this temperature map over the sky in appropriate ways, then what you can pick out, for example, that's sometimes known as the power spectrum. These are variations in the temperature, or if you like, in the color on this map in different places. So you look on the sky at all places separated by 1 degree, measure the temperature difference at all separations of 1 degree over the entire celestial sphere, and then take the average. And then you plot on 1 degree, what you thought your answer was. This is in microdegrees squared. And then you do this for all angular separations. Half a degree is the angular size of the sun or the moon on the sky, for perspective. They're, of course, roughly the same. That's why we occasionally have complete eclipses of the sun. So this picture here, the solid curve, is what you would expect from a typical inflationary model, and the dots are the observational points. And the shape of the prediction, you can see, is rather characteristic. There are these peaks. It's rather like sound level with the ringing of a bell. There are great cosmic sound waves of density which are being damped out as they get to smaller and smaller and smaller sizes. So within this picture, there's a huge amount of information in the widths of these peaks, the heights of the peaks, the number of them, and so on, about the makeup of the universe, its expansion dynamics, and so on. For example, the location of this first peak tells you how close you are to that critical expansion rate. And I think this picture shows it's important proof that the general idea of the universe having undergone a period of acceleration in its very, very early stages, 10 to the minus 35 of a second, seems to be in good agreement with these observations. There are details about the nature of the inflation to unravel, but if there hadn't been inflation, one would have a picture that would have a rather flatter type of profile for this power spectrum, a very different type of observational prediction. So remarkably, we can make these observations which give us direct, testable evidence as to what the universe was like when it was about 10 to the minus 35 of a second old. A month or so ago, probably a bit more now, you probably read in the newspapers there was much publicity for a dramatic discovery, not from a satellite, but from observations made at the South Pole, which is a venue that's very good for radio astronomy because it's extremely dry and it's at relatively high altitude. And the BICEP 2 experiment that's been observing there for a long time, claimed to have found evidence for the radiation's polarization states being rotated in a particular patch of the sky, so twisted rather like these pictures here. And this is a signature of another type of variation in that little primordial patch that grows into our universe, a variation created by waves of gravitation, so-called gravitational radiation. Sensitivity of that experiment is about 10 times better than the Planck mission, but of course, Planck mission is observing the whole sky, not just one patch. So there's much interest in whether there really is disagreement between this discovery and the Planck mission, whether the other experiments at the South Pole, there are two others that ought to be able to repeat these observations within the next year and confirm or rule them out, and the Planck mission theory team that are based in Cambridge, rather secretive, won't tell you anything, but I'm sure that soon they will release their sky maps of this exact part of the sky and see whether they agree with these observations or not, which seemed to be the case in their original publication. So there is much going on right now in this investigation and in these studies. All the things I've said so far about inflation are things that are eminently testable. They follow standard scientific rules and regulations. But inflation has all sorts of unusual and seemingly inevitable consequences. And these have much greater metaphysical implications. The first of these is something that's known as chaotic inflation. And it convinces you that geography is a much more complicated subject than when you were at school. We talked just now about this one little patch of space near the beginning of the expansion, which inflates and accelerates, and if it lasts for long enough, can become big enough to encompass the whole of our visible universe. If it doesn't inflate for long enough, it won't become old enough and big enough for carbon and stars and galaxies and life to develop in the way that we talked about earlier. But of course, there are other regions outside that initial one. Could think of it as a foam of bubbles, and they're all heated up in a fairly random way. Some of them will inflate a lot. Some of them might not inflate at all. Some of them might inflate much more. Some of them might still be inflating. So if we could look beyond our visible horizon today, this theory predicts that eventually we should start to find that the universe is structured in a very different way. Very different density, different temperature, different expansion, and in some variants of this theory, different fundamental features of physics, maybe all antimatter rather than matter, or maybe without a weak force of radioactivity, or maybe with a stronger force of gravity. So this is philosophically very interesting. There have always been skeptical philosophers who took a rather minimalist view that you couldn't be sure that the universe was the same beyond our horizon because we hadn't seen. This is the first time that there has been a positive prediction that we should expect the universe to ultimately be very different in structure if you go far enough beyond our horizon. So that's why geography is a more complicated subject than you might have thought. But then people pointed out that you should expect history to be a more complicated subject as well. Because if this is the little patch that inflates to form our whole visible universe, in most varieties of these theories, those inflating patches create within themselves the conditions needed for further inflation to occur of little parts of themselves. So inflation is like a self-reproducing process that once it begins, it never ends. And it's a fractal process, like a branching process. And so we see ourselves as residing in one of those patches that's undergone a lot of inflation. If we could see beyond our horizon, we should expect to see most of the universe still undergoing inflation. And this process has become known as internal inflation, because just as it appears that there will be no end to the process, it seems very likely that there need be no beginning to it as well. The answer to the question, did the universe have a beginning, has a new and slightly different answer within this cosmic scenario. So our expanding patch did indeed have a beginning at a moment of in time when the inflated expansion began. But the whole network of reproducing patches need not have a beginning, as far as we know at the moment. This scenario is sometimes known as the multiverse, and it could be that these new apparent discoveries of gravitational radiation from inflation may place important constraints on whether this type of process indeed took place or not. So whether the detailed variety of inflation that can give rise to those gravitational waves can also produce this self-reproduction. Finally, we should ask and try and give some answer to the question, okay, we've said something about the beginning of the universe. What do we think about the future? Will the universe expand forever? Well, it's a moot point, as the lawyers would say, because there are other known problems completely independent of inflation that make the long-range forecast for our bit of the universe rather pessimistic. We know that the Sun is about 4.6 billion years into its life cycle since its birth, along with the solar system. The stellar evolution will gradually cause a warming of the Sun over many billions of years, until about 5.5 billion years to the future, something rather catastrophic will occur. The sun will have run out of hydrogen, and it will try to resolve this energy crisis by expanding dramatically. But then, after it exhausts other fuel, it will implode, blowing off a ring of material that astronomers call a planetary nebula. Here is a Hubble Space Telescope picture of the death of another star, perhaps with a planetary system, that seems to have created two rings. Perhaps there are two stars, or there's something complicated going on with magnetic fields. So after that, the sun will have died and will just be a cooled, very dense, dark object, the size of the Earth, about 1 million times denser. So this is the fate of the solar system. All stars will eventually follow that type of fate, perhaps some to black holes, some to neutron stars. But the expansion of the universe that we now understand from these observations from space and the attempts to extrapolate Hubble's law to greater and greater distances have discovered that if you look far enough, the expansion of the universe starts to speed up and accelerate. So here is our picture again of size against time. The universe inflates down here. It then resumes its normal expansion until 4 or 5 billion years ago, and then it starts to change gear and to accelerate as though it is inflating all over again. But the mechanism cannot be the same as it was back here. So we live now in a regime where the universe is accelerating ever rapidly to the future. It's on a trajectory which is not going apparently to collapse in the future to a big crunch, but is going to keep on expanding, rarefying to lower temperature and lower density, and eventually it will create an environment where there is a horizon around us which is much, much smaller than it is today. And all the other galaxies will pass beyond that horizon, and we will no longer, in the far, far future, be able to make any cosmological observations anymore. We will not be able to determine that the universe is expanding. We will not be able to observe the background radiation from the Big Bang, because it will not be able to penetrate our galaxy. Plasma frequency for that radiation will become equal to the plasma frequency for the material within our galaxy. What was discovered by observations, by those satellite experiments and others, is that the universe today has a curious makeup. It has only about 5% of its constituent is stuff that makes you and me and planet Earth. There is then about 27% of material whose gravitational effects we see everywhere we look, but it doesn't shine in the dark, so-called dark matter. It's strongly believed that this material is a form of elementary particle that is yet to be discovered, a type of neutrino that is perhaps 30 or 50 times more massive than a hydrogen atom. And the next round of experiments in CERN with the Large Hadron Collider are designed to find that new type of particle. After the discovery of the Higgs boson, this was the next great goal for the Large Hadron Collider, to identify a particle that could explain the existence of dark matter in our galaxy and in every other galaxy that we look at. Finally, there is the material that is causing this acceleration to the expansion of the universe. And it's become known as dark energy. It must be the same type of material that gives rise to inflation in the very early universe. But we don't know its detailed identity. We're not able to predict this number. We don't know why it suddenly came into play to accelerate the universe just a few billion years ago. These are the biggest unsolved problems, both in astronomy, in cosmology, and also in fundamental physics. Maybe one of the younger people in the audience here today might be the person who is able to solve that great question. Thank you.